I think they might be looking more at a Tiananmen-like scenario from their own people, in that there's got to be exceedingly high unreported unemployment. And the families that have been affected by this are going to feel the pain of that impact for a long time. And I just believe in the current era, it's going to be harder, even though China maintains amazingly effective controls over information. It's going to be harder for them to conceal the realities of this than it has been for them to whitewash the realities and legacy of Tiananmen.
Just what is the significance of Deputy National Security Advisor Matt Pottinger recently giving a speech from the White House in fluent Mandarin? How does this coronavirus outbreak expose the dangers posed by China's communist regime and its authoritarian system? And, with mounting global criticism of the Chinese regime, will this be a Tiananmen-like moment for China, with countries around the world sanctioning the regime for its massacre of student protesters? In this episode, we sit down with Steve Yates, CEO of DC International Advisory. Fluent in Mandarin Chinese, he previously served in the White House as Deputy Assistant to the Vice President from 2001 to 2005, with a focus on national security affairs. This is American Thought Leaders, and I'm Jekielek. Steve Yates, such a pleasure to have you on American Thought Leaders.
Thank you for having me.
So, Steve, we're in very interesting times here. We have the so-called wolf warrior Chinese diplomats around the world, including in the U.S., doing what I would argue very undiplomatic things, saying very undiplomatic things, to put it lightly. At this time, you know, it's a curious day, May 4th, we have Deputy National Security Advisor Matt Pottinger appear on video speaking fluent Chinese with a, I think, an unprecedented message. And, you know, you actually alerted me to this just a little while ago before this happened, which I immensely appreciated. And tell me what you're seeing with this. I mean, this is incredible stuff.
Well, it was unprecedented in my experience. I spent 5 years in the White House, and I've tried to watch the administration before and those who've come since. And I don't think we've ever had this high ranking of a national security official who was truly fluent in Chinese, and then made good official strategic use of that language ability. I was a deputy national security advisor to the vice president, a very different role. And so Matt has a unique life experience. I think what we saw on display, given he has some experience as a journalist, he's a very good communicator. And he did a very good job of putting together what I think is a very powerful narrative, one that I think should connect with Chinese people. And so he did, with regard to communicating to China, what I think President Trump does in communicating with Americans, which is to go around the big media. And so Matt Pottinger, I should say, instead of being so familiar with him, the Deputy National Security Advisor, gave a remarkable address talking about the May 4th movement. It's 101 years ago today, largely focused on citizen-led, reform-minded governance in China. And so Matt not only spoke in fluent Chinese linguistically, he spoke in fluent Chinese history in a way that kind of took a giant leap past the 70-plus years of communist censorship that tried to whitewash the Republican era intellectual debate in China, pretending as if it was just the imperial era, and then there was a corrupt Chiang Kai-shek regime, and then Mao and his revolution came to save the day. When Matt was, I think, in very effective detail talking about the politics of that time that I think accurately represent the aspirations of Chinese people. And so in our exchange, I noted an irony that probably comes across more clearly in English than in Chinese, but we have a white man in the White House speaking in Chinese about Chinese history in a way that is probably more effective and fluent than most Chinese officials are able to do.
大家早安, 我是 Matt Pottinger.
And so I thought it was an amazing example of strategic communication, but it was a very, very important message in terms of content, basically saying that the ideals of democracy and freedom are very well grounded in China's intellectual tradition. And he cited Hushi and Lushun and some other writers that any Chinese educated intellectual would know, and asked what I thought was a provocative but profound and appropriate question of, it's been a century since the May 4th movement. Will the Chinese people have to wait another century to be able to reach these aspirations, or the Chinese Communist Party get out of the way of the information control, disinformation, and deception business, and basically respect these traditions? So I thought it was incredibly compelling. I've never heard an American official speak this directly in Chinese this effectively.
You know, in my Twitter feed, I kind of live tweeted this thing. And in my Twitter feed, someone that we communicate often publicly that way, Salman Yue, he mentioned, he felt like this is the basically akin to Reagan's call to Gorbachev to tear down this wall. What do you think about that?
Well, Solomon is a friend and a colleague. I served on the Republican National Committee together with him. And we often do refer to the Chinese Communist Party as an evil empire, and that this is the evil empire of our time that needs to be overcome. And it's not meant to be put in a combative or negative way that it's an American operation. It's really about, as Matt was talking about, appealing to the history, culture, and sensibilities of the Chinese people and saying, we look forward to celebrating your success in meeting those aspirations. That includes economic development, but also these other human values. The fact that there was a role in Chinese leadership defining international, global standards for human rights and democracy, it's just a profound part of the history that has been lost from the narrative, frankly, from the Henry Kissinger opening until now, where people basically accepted the Communist Party of China as the government of China, instead of basically the ruling party of a time, which is really more consistent with Chinese history.
You know, it's very interesting because even there, Matt Pottinger, he references this idea that this is my read, okay, is that this idea of freedom actually even predates the May 4th movement. This is something that comes out of Chinese history. And also just this kind of desire for a plurality of voices, that was something that was very strong in the speech. And because that, you know, we can kind of see today in the time of coronavirus what the cost of the lack of that is.
Right. And that's a point I think that Matt drove home very, very clearly. Some of us do it more bluntly in talking about it. I thought he was very diplomatic, frankly, and basically making clear and acknowledging that no one has suffered more in reality, but also in an opportunity cost, than the Chinese people have. No matter what anyone wants to say about the Chinese people having grown up out of poverty, well, that poverty was imposed upon them by bad government, in many cases based on Chinese Communist Party policies. In fact, in part of the speech today, Matt Pottinger made reference to Mao Zedong's reaction to some of these May 4th movement writers when asked if they were alive today, meaning during Mao's time, what would they be doing? He said basically they'd be free to write in jail or be quiet. And that was the openness the Communist Party had to these very deeply held Chinese intellectual ideas.
So this comes at a very interesting time, you know, as I led in. We have all this messaging that's coming out of China, of course, focused on coronavirus, because, well, you know, there's a preponderance of evidence. Every day I'm seeing more and more of it that you know, I think at best it was grossly mismanaged and hidden, and at worst, you know, a much worse situation. What in this context, what is the significance of this speech?
Well, I mean, basically the way I frame what's happened with the virus is that China's government, either out of incompetence or malice, harmed the lives of many, many, many Chinese people, and then allowed this to spread to the rest of the world, infecting very, very large numbers of people, killing large numbers of people, and killing jobs. And so they're going to face a degree of blowback from that. And the government of China has been revving up its propaganda organs to try to flip the narrative away from where did the virus come from, in what ways did China deceive its people, deceive the World Health Organization, by way of the World Health Organization, deceive the world in ways that very measurably cost lives and jobs, significant amounts. And so they have a significant vested interest in trying to flip this narrative. So they've tried to make everything focus more on how has President Trump personally responded to this, which in some ways is echoing what American domestic political entities are doing, whether it's the Democratic Party or the dominant media. But really, there's a cynical motive for China in trying to do this, and it's just obfuscating the responsibility. Because what's been most remarkable is that China had a good thing going for some time. They were buying influence in international organizations. The One Belt, One Road was buying relationships across Central Asia and Africa and a few other places. A lot of the European countries were essentially very friendly. The government of Canada had been very, very friendly. Then things started to change a little bit with the controversy over Huawei, the detention of Canadian aid workers, the controversies over communications and national security networks, and then the Hong Kong demonstrations. But really with this virus, they've really jumped the shark, where you end up with the leader of Germany, someone who's seen as very mainstream and very open to dealing with China in a conciliatory way, saying very clearly China must pay a price to cover the impact that this has had on Germany and Europe. And certainly in the United States, it's not a Trump issue or a White House issue. Republicans and Democrats across the country, if not in Washington itself, really have a broad base of distrust and concern about how we were misled and the costs that we are paying now. And they see this hostile diplomacy that China is engaged in. They see the mean tweets. They see the very cynical videos that are being produced that are trying to blame America for something that every American, but also every Japanese, every Taiwanese, every Singaporean, every Hong Konger, every German, every Brit, every Canadian, every Mexican, we all know who did this. And again, it's either out of incompetence or malice. There really is no other avenue that this happened by way of China. It's their failed standards or a hostile intent that drove this pandemic outbreak. And so the significance of a deputy national security advisor talking about this now is trying to take away, I think, one of the cynical tools the Communist Party has had, which is to hide its own incompetence, malice, and destruction inside of China by blaming the foreigner, blaming the outsider. And so why would they want to do that? Well, because we know that the number of cases and fatalities and job losses in China are far greater than they have publicly acknowledged. And we saw in the 1980s, leading up to the Tiananmen Square movement, that when you have inflation and mass unemployment, the Communist Party government can be brought to the brink. And so I think they must have real concerns. They saw this political movement in Hong Kong that opened Pandora's box. Now there's a massive economic downturn that I'm sure we don't have accurate figures about, and they must blame the demon on the outside in order to try to hold on to their people. And so Matt, hopefully finding a way to communicate in common sense, appeal to the better angels of Chinese culture and history, maybe, just maybe, can make a crack in that great firewall of China and let that conversation grow just a bit.
Well, that's fascinating. And there's kind of two vantage points I wanna go with from this one. First of all, there's this, Reuters report where we're kind of looking into sort of verify the document that they say they talked to someone who saw, which is basically saying that the Chinese regime itself is basically seeing that there is a kind of Tiananmen-style backlash happening internationally and that they need to kind of guard against or deal with which presumably all this, quote-unquote diplomacy is about. So that's one vantage point. The second one, so I don't forget, is simply, it's almost like Mr. Pottinger is basically offering, he's communicating directly with the Chinese people here. That's kind of what struck me with this, right? And that's also something that I don't think I've seen a lot of from high-level U.S. officials.
I think they had wanted to. I don't think that we have had, as I mentioned before, someone of his rank with that level of fluency in Chinese. As I would double emphasize, also with that level of fluency in modern Chinese history, not the fortune cookie version of Chinese history that far too many American leaders and business leaders draw upon, but a real reading of real intellectual and political history over the last century plus. He's a uniquely qualified person to engage in this kind of conversation. If the Reuters report is correct, that the Chinese government fears that they're at a Tiananmen-like moment, and their definition of a Tiananmen-like moment is the world imposing sanctions on them for something bad that they did. And really all of the Jiang Zemin era of Chinese government was first and foremost meant to climb out from under the cloud of the Tiananmen Square massacre. And so it went from that heavy sanctioned China in a recession, probably depression, to a robust growing Chinese economy about to be embraced into the World Trade Organization. And that was the Jiang legacy. So that's how they look at it. I think they might be right, just in a way they don't intend. I think they might be looking more at a Tiananmen-like scenario from their own people. In that there's got to be exceedingly high unreported unemployment, and the families that have been affected by this are going to feel the pain of that impact for a long time. And I just believe in the current era, it's going to be harder, even though China maintains amazingly effective controls over information. It's going to be harder for them to conceal the realities of this than it has been for them to whitewash the realities and legacy of Tiananmen.
It's interesting. When I think of Jiang Zemin, it's curious how you describe his legacy, because I think of two things. I think of putting down Tiananmen Square, right? Democracy dying, same day. My heritage is Polish. Same day, first post-communist elections in Poland, same day Tiananmen Square massacre commences, dramatically different directions, 1989. That is astounding. The second thing is the billion-dollar murder for organs industry that the Chinese state runs. To me, that's Jiang Zemin's legacy.
Yeah, well, certainly the reporting that has been out there on that, it's been enduring. It's tragic in a sense that there have been massive, deep moral problems inside of the Chinese structure for a long time. And as bad as things were in the 1990s, things arguably were never worse than they were when Nixon and Kissinger decided to normalize relations. It was in the middle of the great proletariat cultural revolution. And there was mass murder of people going on in many different ways. There was economic depression going on. It was probably among the worst of times in Chinese history. And yet we chose, for strategic reasons in the Cold War, to lean to a side for the larger battle against the Soviets. And most of my career from the 80s until now has been at a time when people basically acknowledge that China has come from a position of tragedy, perhaps evil in some people, in my view, certainly evil, to one where we aim to try to help lift them out of that state by offering engagement and development. And I think for most of us, and you've interviewed some of my fellow travelers in this regard, we would describe our journey as having been mugged by reality. And that is a saying that was used by Irving Kristol when he was wrote the defining book on neoconservatism. And he was a Democrat who, based on Cold War national security strategy, became a Republican, became a conservative. And he said he was basically an idealist and a liberal, but he was mugged by the reality of what the Soviet Union was and the brutality of the regime. And that's what made him a hawk. And so for a lot of us who've worked in government in various forms, have seen the realities of China through our government work, through other kinds of activities, you know, we have been somewhat mugged by reality. And we want that moral story to connect with Americans and move them. But whether it was the Tibetan movement and Richard Gere's passionate speech at one of the big Hollywood awards, or the Taiwan elections and the DPP coming out of relative obscurity to becoming a ruling party, a tremendous development in democratization. You can go down the list of the things that you would have thought would grab the heartstrings. And most recently, the protests in Hong Kong. I mean, 2 out of 7 million people hitting the streets in Hong Kong is just an unthought of proportion of a population. And any culture, and certainly the way people think of Confucian culture or the Asian values conundrum that we had a debate over in the past. But even with all of that, I think it has taken until this virus outbreak for people to internalize, oh, I can't really afford to just coast in my life and pretend like this problem isn't going to come to my household. It's affecting my household. It's affecting my community. It's affecting my country. And I think that that visceral awareness has done things that the organ harvesting story, the oppression against Uyghurs and mass internment camps, the Tibetan experience, the house church movement, I think the disgraceful efforts to control the Catholic Church in China, all these things should have caught to the people's heartstrings, but we haven't really been able to pull that together in a way that moved, I think, a critical mass of Americans until really now, I hope and I believe. And I think that Matt Pottinger's speech today, it might not have happened in a previous time because we have this confluence of presidential priorities. You know, the president has spent every day for the last month and a half to 2 months having to publicly address the response to this problem. And so there's a feeling at a visceral level of what the work that has been created by this and the cost of it in human terms and economic terms. And I think they see the malice of the Chinese government in ways that can't be brushed aside as theoretical or hypothetical the way our academics and diplomats had in the past. So I respect the organ harvesting, the suffering of Falun Gong, the suffering of the Uyghurs, the suffering of the Tibetans, the sufferings of the millions of my friends in Taiwan and Hong Kong. But unfortunately, it's taken this global tragedy to really get us focused and get this conversation going now. Again, 101 years after the May 4th movement should have opened this conversation more broadly to the Chinese people.
You know, my father-in-law is a Holocaust survivor, and my wife, she had a very interesting post that she wrote. She actually was very thoughtful. She sent it over to me. Look at this. Do you think I can say this? But basically, she describes this whole situation with coronavirus as the "and then they came for me" moment. You know, that famous, I guess, I don't know if it's a poem, but yeah. So this is the point where everyone at least should realize, oh, these are the consequences of this system, and they affect me too.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, it should get everyone's attention when you're talking about 30 million filers for unemployment, when you're talking about tens of thousands of deaths in a very, very short period of time. And then you have on top of that the sense of panic that both of those figures create in terms of worries about the future, economically and health-wise. It's a more effective form of terrorism than the terrorism we've dealt with since 9/11. And I think people feel violated in a fundamental way when they're dealing with this kind of a situation. And then when they see the government that was responsible for it turn around and very cynically try to blame us for the problem, then I think you've really finally gone that final 10 yards on the field and convinced America, okay, you now want to be our enemy. We wanted to be friends. We wanted to give you the benefit of the doubt. We wanted to believe in engagement. Now you've made clear that we don't get what we want. You want this conflict with us. You want us to suffer.
Steve, so, you know, very, very interesting. You mentioned, you know, it's either gross incompetence or it's malfeasance, you know, or somewhere in the range or in that range. Secretary of State of Pompeo has been increasingly describing what intelligence, I guess, has been gathered, what they figured out. Can you speak to just how you understand the current level of knowledge of what actually happened? What's your take on what, you know, how you assemble all this information that's out there? Because it's plentiful, right, and sometimes moving in different directions.
Right. Well, I certainly don't have more or higher quality information than the Secretary of State has. But I think all of us, I mean, some of this are basically stories that are hiding in plain sight. You know, we can look back on media coverage and, you know, courtesy of things like Twitter, we know what the Chinese government was saying in December and January and February. We know what the World Health Organization was saying in December, January, and February. And we know that in China, when this was a significant outbreak, it was actually covered by the Chinese media, and it was called the Wuhan virus. And it was very, very clear where it was coming from. It wasn't coming from Guangdong. It wasn't coming from Shanghai. It wasn't coming from Tokyo. And it sure wasn't coming from America. It was the Wuhan virus. It wasn't until it really went international and became a reputational problem for the government of China that they began to play the most cynical of games in trying to say it was racist, to call it Chinese. And so we have the record of truth on the one hand, and some of these saved social media, traditional media posts about where the outbreak was and what the nature of the outbreak was. It was quite scary. And then we also have the revisionism that has been, I think, unprecedentedly aggressive in terms of trying to whitewash and flip the narrative. What I try to do, and what I think a lot of other people try to do that want to advise our friends that are in government or be helpful to them, we try to track what's happening in the Chinese media just to know what they're saying. We also keep track of what our own government agencies are saying publicly. But in this case, there's a lot of international coverage that's out there. And guess what? It's very consistent with what Secretary Pompeo has been saying. The leadership in Japan has been more forthright and direct in talking about Chinese responsibility for this, and also the Chinese manipulation of the World Health Organization. The Deputy Prime Minister of Japan said that it shouldn't be called the World Health Organization anymore. It should be called the Chinese Health Organization because of their manipulation of information in process. That's unprecedented. If we're going to talk about the Deputy National Security Advisor's unprecedented speech, that was an unprecedented statement. The government of Australia, but also Australia's major news networks, have done deep dives into the background of what's gone on with this virus, but also the very ugly racist nationalism that the government of China has engaged in trying to flip this narrative. And so it's very, very clear, I think, to the world and to those of us from America trying to watch what's happening to the world, that this is a China problem, a Chinese government problem. If we want to be optimistic, we side with Mr. Pottinger and say, We're hopeful that the Chinese people will hear this reminder of the ideals of May 4th and that they will rise to the occasion, and citizen-led government can be in the future. And that's all consistent with Chinese culture and civilization. But if we're in the now and we're more cynical about it, then we're back with everyone in the world is seeing very, very clearly where this came from. And they felt the pain in their own economies and among their people. And they've seen the breakdown of these international organizations. And so we're not in a critique of Donald Trump as a person or a presidency. We're not in, is America moving toward isolationism? It's that these institutions themselves have completely failed. And there's no better measure of that than jobs and lives lost in this outbreak, courtesy of a specialized agency of the United Nations that allowed the government of China, that isn't even in the top 10 funders of the organization, to completely control the narrative, dialogue, and substance of that organization, to the detriment of humanity and even to the detriment of the Chinese people's well-being. It's just a remarkable series of developments to see. But when you're looking at it, I mean, Secretary Pompeo hears from his counterparts, and you got to believe that they're more blunt and candid in person than they are in what we see through the media. And I just have never seen as blunt a review of what's happening with China and the negative feedback they're getting in their bilateral relations with China than I've heard recently from European counterparts, Asian counterparts generally, the Australians and others. It's just been it's been decidedly negative. And so Secretary Pompeo is in many ways just speaking in ways that sum up what a lot of these observations and sentiments are and put the burden where it belongs. If China doesn't like the narrative, open up and be transparent. To this day, we still don't have independent experts being able to go in unfettered and do the forensic analysis of where did this actually come from? How has it been spreading? And that's after months of destruction of that forensic trail by the Chinese government.
You know, and to your point about this situation with, all these different governments basically taking stands when they really weren't ready to do that until very recently. I mean, this whole idea that the Chinese government is going out and accusing, you know, all these Western countries are being racist for calling it the China virus or the Wuhan virus, and at the same time facilitating the targeting of Africans, predominantly people, you know, from the African continent, as being the people who are bringing the virus in from outside. You know, I can't hardly imagine something more racist, right, than that. And now you even have African leaders, to some extent, which probably the most difficult for them to take stands like this, actually saying something here. I mean, that's remarkable to me.
Well, I'm an American conservative, and we're usually pretty critical of what we would call establishment thinking and the globalist ideas. But globalists and the establishment thought leaders, so to speak, have argued basically for the last generation that America is ceding leadership in the world and others are rising. And, you know, those that believe in the values of our Constitution, ideas of federalism in the United States, institutions like religion and other kinds of socializing forces, that those were a bygone era and this new postmodern existence is going to be the way of the world. And we're going to have a rise of Chinese power and influence. We just have to accept that and make an accommodation. And China is just so much better at soft power than we are. And some of this soft power is spreading money around and infrastructure development around the continent of Africa, Latin America, some parts of the broader Asian continent, Eastern Europe included as well. And that China is buying so much goodwill with this that they're just better at all of this public relations. And the United States is just caught up in its own internal politics and disorder, and so we're seeding this leadership vacuum. That has never fully been true anyway, but it's decidedly now being proven untrue, both in terms of the American decline narrative, but also in terms of this automatic and generally accepted notion that China is ascending and that it's some master at this soft power. There is no worse example of the Chinese government having tragically terrible unforced errors on so-called soft power than this example of the McDonald's having an official policy in southern China not to serve black people. That and in Chinese it was Heiren. It wasn't people from Africa. It was color of skin. And there were consular officers from the American consulate in that area that were affected by this as African Americans. You did end up with on video people hitting the streets in China, verbally assaulting, borderline physically accosting African diplomats in southern China over this threat of you're dirty and you brought this virus to us. Part of the sort of mental reprogramming that the CCP was trying to do, it gets caught on video, but now you end up with images of African diplomats demanding apologies from government officials in China, and the Chinese government officials having to go and bow an apology. And so this was all created by this supposedly infallible soft power juggernaut of the CCP. I just think it's somewhat useful to recognize they're not in fact 10 feet tall. They're selling a very, very flawed product, an evil product, and they're not even doing it very well right now. And so I hope that African countries, European countries, Americans, and our counterparts around the world recognize these institutions like the United Nations, the Human Rights Commission, the World Health Organization, all these organizations that essentially have failed their fundamental missions on security and human rights. Now we need to do basically as President Trump asserted, we're going to need to cooperate among sovereign states to build a balance against the failed agenda of these organizations that have been hijacked by primarily the CCP. So it can be a constructive lesson that we're learning not to worry so much about who's funding these groups and how much money, but certainly don't waste our taxpayer money to insult ourselves and put our own people at risk. If our allies and partners around the world are wising up that this Chinese offer of a quick project and capital comes with strings, and they'll demand that you behave like a puppet, like the Director General of the World Health Organization has had to do. He has basically had to parrot the words the CCP told him to parrot, like trying to say that that person-to-person transmission of this is not possible, a known falsehood at the time. Should be something that would require someone's resignation or firing under normal circumstances, but we're not in normal circumstances. So to me, the ripple effects of this are profound. The Chinese efforts at soft power, one belt, one road, trying to build up this coalition of influence, I think they've really lost that momentum and it's rolling back the other way. They can't blame the world for it. They did this to themselves.
That's interesting. You know, they're definitely not 10 feet tall, as you had said. That's a kind of a bit of a mirage. Yet they do, let me flip it around a little bit, they do still exert influence, and they're trying to, especially in some of the smaller countries, like we're hearing reports from Sweden. Sweden is pushing back, but are getting, you know, diplomats saying completely outrageous things. You know, in Taiwan, which of course this is an area that's kind of part of your specialty, Taiwan is basically, I've heard people from there saying, well, now you're feeling the kind of pressure that we've been feeling all along. Now you kind of understand what it's like to be in Taiwan, right? And then, of course, you know, the place where the Chinese Communist Party has the greatest influence, which is Hong Kong, where we have, you know, 15, you know, strong pro-democracy leaders being arrested, and this sort of, you know, at least in my view, basic law being, you know, undermined at a level that I hadn't really seen before. So there is still some strength there. And I just, what are your thoughts here?
No question, there is some strength there, and also no question that the Chinese Communist Party, with just a little bit of juice in its tank or money in its bank account, is definitely willing to multiply it, spend it, deploy it. And so even under siege, frankly, from the outbreak of the virus and the economic impact of it inside of China, they have not held back in trying to push political pressure on the democracy movement in Hong Kong. It would appear to be a cynical move of the world being distracted with its own coronavirus response and perhaps not focusing on the Hong Kong situation, plus the Hong Kong authorities enforcing social distancing and things like that. It's a very convenient way to eliminate the mass protest movement that had gotten so much international media attention. And so there's no question that the government of China still has leverage and is very, very willing to use that leverage in ways that most others would be bashful about or feel a little bit of shame about. They don't feel that. And so there's no question they push very, very hard to not let a good crisis go to waste, as we say in American politics. And I think there's something to what the people of Taiwan are saying of now you know, because no geography on the planet per capita has been attacked more frequently than the people of Taiwan have, and that those 23 million people on an island offshore. Just in terms of cyber attacks, political warfare, economic warfare, and actual military materiel that's deployed against them, I mean, there's all of this craziness in international organizations trying to force companies and groups to not even utter the word Taiwan. That absolute joke of a World Health Organization official who refused to answer the Hong Kong journalist's question about Taiwan's handling of the coronavirus. I mean, what a dereliction of duty. Even if you're full-on communist and you believe the unreality that Taiwan belongs to the People's Republic of China, you should still be able to answer the question about how Taiwan handled the coronavirus, a subject the World Health Organization should find exceedingly relevant. But he played around with turning off his connection, said I'd already addressed the Chinese issue, but basically made very, very clear how corrupted it had become. And so, Taiwan faces a unique challenge in this, but now the rest of the world sees with the manufactured narratives that are going out on social media, videos, the mean tweets by diplomats from China, trying to mobilize Chinese nationals in foreign territory to militantly attack other Chinese people who might think differently. It's a different phenomenon than has been apparent in recent times. But it's very, very aggressive. And I think there's a lot of truth to what some of our friends in Taiwan and Hong Kong have said. Yeah, don't forget, these guys still have some malice left in what they're trying to do. And the only antidote to it is if smaller countries are feeling this bullying, then the larger countries have a responsibility to stand by the side of those that are willing to speak up about what's right. When the government of Poland or the Czech Republic is willing to take the right stand on these things, the government of the United States needs to do that. And we should be shaming other European countries that won't do the same thing if we're willing to stand up for what's obviously true and generally good for the values we hold in common. So, don't wait for the UN. Don't wait for the next meeting. Our diplomats basically need to do more of what we saw Deputy National Security Pottinger do and get out and speak directly to the Chinese people, but also speak in solidarity with the others around the world that are taking the right tack.
You know, again, two vantage points. You know, just this last bit that you mentioned, something that struck me about Matt Pottinger's address was how almost disarming and genuine it was. I mean, I kind of felt like I wonder if this will, you know, culturally appear this way to Chinese. It certainly appeared this way to me. He did not come off as a politician to me. He came off as someone who was speaking genuinely to the Chinese people, right? Which I thought was, you know, kind of remarkable.
Well, I think it came across that way to me. I trust it came across that way to Chinese listeners around the world that were tuning into it. And anyone who knows Matt Pottinger knows that he isn't a politician. He's an intelligent man. I'm sure that he has some familiarity with the realities of politics, especially in the last few years of his job experience. But first and foremost, he's someone who has clear life experience, clear views, and a clear ability to articulate them in a way that is, frankly, more consistent with what he's done in the past than what he's doing right now. And I didn't detect an ounce of disingenuousness about what he was saying. This wasn't propaganda. This wasn't a political or polemic message. This was an appeal to people that he clearly celebrates and likes. He has people that are deeply close to him that he loves that are Chinese. So he's, I think, fairly safe from the accusation of racism, which gets trotted out all the time. And he's not anti-China. And I thought that the way he articulated his views probably would come across better than someone like me trying to articulate my views, and that he could speak from this vantage point of really earnestly identifying with that freedom movement from that earlier period in China and close friends and collaborators that he had known during his time living in China really fed the growth of that thought and identity inside of him. So I think that's just a genuine part of who he is. And frankly, that's a big net positive for American policy right now and in terms of dealing with the Chinese government.
You know, Steve, something just struck me as we're talking right now. It's, you know, one of the very common lines that we hear from Chinese Communist Party spokespeople and diplomats is that you've hurt the feelings of the Chinese people, yeah, as if they can speak for everyone. Well, you know, I feel like Matt Pottinger's speech, it's almost like it disarms that favorite piece of messaging or something. Doesn't it?
Well, I think there was style and substance that did that. And his style was as you described. He has a very disarming style because he is not a caustic or confrontational kind of person by nature. He's focused on substance, not necessarily on trying to take shots. He doesn't hold back from things that are sensitive and important. I think that should be very clear from anyone who reviews the text, which I would strongly encourage that people get their own firsthand impression from the text, from the video, not just my impressions or interpretation of it. But I just his style, I think, was very professional and genuine. But then the substance, by speaking in the voice of Chinese intellectuals from 100 years ago, it's true. These intellectuals said these words. It has a context in the Chinese intellectual tradition. It is relevant to discussions between citizens and their government in Chinese history and political development. So it's not a message from American politics to Chinese politics. It's not a message from the Republican Party or Democratic Party to the Chinese Communist Party. It was, I think, a very genuine, historically based message from someone who knows and is inspired by that movement to the Chinese people to hopefully awaken and endorse that kind of a revival and intellectual conversation inside China about their own government and its accountability.
Well, right. And, you know, we talked about this a little bit offline as well. Chinese people aren't all that fragile as this right. messaging would suggest, right?
Right. Yeah, there's a video and probably more than one that are circulating widely on YouTube that ask somewhat the curious question of are the Chinese people really all that sensitive? And of course, Chinese people are human beings like the rest of us. I'm sure there are sensitivities that all of us carry, but a lot of people who've lived for many years in China know that there are a lot of Chinese people that have an incredible toughness about them, a matter of factness about the realities of their life, partly what allowed them to work very, very hard under not that great of conditions over the last generation to develop the economic juggernaut that the world recognizes speaks to the lack of focus on feelings and more of pragmatism, hard work, somewhat of a toughness. And that comes out of living through a depression and starvation on just physical body, but also politics. Yes, I think this is one of those false notions that the Chinese people aren't tough and focused on the realities of their lives. But it's been the Communist Party of China that has used this mostly to manipulate outsiders, somewhat to try to manipulate their own domestic audience, but it's been most effective in manipulating outsiders. Fact of the matter is, the people who are dying of this virus in Wuhan and other parts of China, they didn't spend a moment of any day worrying about whether the people of Taiwan want to consider themselves to be a part of China or not, or whether the people of Hong Kong want to directly elect all of their legislative council, not just some of their legislative council, and one day their chief executive. They don't spend a moment of any day worrying about what the conditions are of Tibetans or Uyghurs or others. They have all of these pressing things that they're dealing with in their own life. And so it's really, I think, a manipulative tool of their government to try to fan these things and pretend as if the Chinese people are so sensitive that they can't handle a mention of one of these words, or they just sort of curl up into a fetal ball and cry at the mention of these different topics. I think those of us that have studied Chinese history and those of us that have real interaction with real Chinese people know that they're fully capable of these ideas that Deputy National Security Advisor Pottinger mentioned, but also they are willing and able to stand up from time to time. And it's just been unfortunate that in recent decades, the government has very, very effectively kind of disaggregated all of these movements from being able to reach a critical mass to push for a different path forward for the Chinese people.
You know, so I, for one, am a huge fan of a plurality of voices, plurality of thought for the Chinese people to get access. I'm wondering to myself, you know, will this video go viral, behind the Great Firewall of China and so forth? Any final thoughts before we finish up?
Well, I certainly hope it does go viral. And I think in keeping with what I think is Matt Pottinger's intention, not so that it's some kind of a declaration from him, but that it provokes a movement of thought, discourse, and debate inside of China. He made very, very clear that the aspirational and respectful interpretation of his remarks was that this future is for the Chinese people to decide. And that this tradition of the May 4th movement and these powerful Chinese intellectual ideas are for the Chinese people to discuss, interpret, and really that when you end up with a small minority that has too much power concentrated for too long, it does risk a popular uprising. In fact, it's what the Communist Party of China tried to do to come to power. Now they have been doing things so long their way that it does appear that if these kinds of ideas go viral, they are now at risk of a popular movement that would push the Communist Party of China off to the side in pursuit of a different, better way of governing themselves.
Steve Yates, such a pleasure to have you on.
Thank you so much.